Good morning, everybody. How are you guys on this precious morning? I pray that you guys are all doing well. I know a lot of you may be at work right now. I know some of you may just be getting up right now. I just pray that you guys are having a good morning. Good morning. Good morning. I pray that you guys are having a great morning. Amen. The topic that I chose this morning is going to be without love in our hearts, we are nothing. God's love. Amen. And I pray, excuse me, that this word that I'm going to give you guys this morning is a blessing. Amen. Over your life. Amen. And I'm going to be reading from 1 Corinthians. Amen. 12:27, and I'm gonna go all the way down to 13:13. Amen. And when you guys have it, you know, just write it down on a little piece of paper, or you know, just keep it for memory, food for thought for the day. Amen. The word of God is read in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. It says, all of you together are Christ's body, and each of you is a part of it. Amen. It says, here are some of the parts God has appointed for the church. Amen. So Paul wanted everybody to understand that as a church, amen, good morning, and as a body, we all play a certain part together, amen. And Paul says, he says, first are apostles, second are prophets, third are teachers, then those who do miracles, amen. He says, those who have the gifts of healing, those who can help others, and those who have a gift in leadership, and those who speak in unknown languages. So now, this part right here is amazing, because he's not only speaking about, not only is he letting us know that the church has certain parts, amen, as the body of believers, amen, so that lets us know that we are not all that. We can't do things on our own strength, amen. And then second, he's letting us know that within the church, there's gonna be apostles first, second prophets, teachers, and people that can do, you know, that have certain gifts, amen. And then he says, are we all apostles, or are we all prophets? Are we all teachers? Do we all have the power to do miracles? Do we all have the gift of healing, and do we all have the ability to speak in unknown languages? So now, if we look at the Bible, we look at the word, he's actually asking us this question so that we can actually reflect, amen, so that we can know as the body of believers where we stand and where other people may stand, amen. It says, do we all have the ability to interpret unknown languages? And look what he says. He says, of course not. So you should earnestly desire the most helpful gifts, amen. So he's letting us know that, you know, if you're in church, you shouldn't be the type of person that goes to church not expecting, not helping out, not doing your part. Amen. And I know that may be frustrating for some people, because I've spoken to a few people where they say that they go to a church and sometimes, you know, they don't put people to work, you know, and some people want to help out, but, you know, they keep people like they say on the pews. But you have to, you know, do what God is calling you to do. And in the church, we have to respect the leadership. And if that's not the place for you and God sends you somewhere else, amen. But, you know, I encourage you as a believer to be in a first, find a church that you're comfortable in. Once you're comfortable in that church, start to really sit down and analyze and say, God, okay, what am I called to do? Because a lot of people, you know, they in a church, but they really don't know what they're called to do. And some of them may have that calling, but then again, some of them may have people in leadership that don't want to let them shine. And, you know, that's something else. But, and if they don't let you shine and you're going through that situation, this word is going to be a blessing to your life, because it's not only going to expose things from a leadership's point of view, but it's also going to expose things through a Christian's point of view that, you know, wants to work and wants to do things for God's ministry. Amen. So let's continue. It says, but now let me show you a way of life that is best of all. So now he's letting you know that he's going to give you a little secret that's better than all this prophecy of speaking in tongues and being able to heal and being able to do miracles and being in a title, having a title of an apostle and having a title as a prophet of God. Paul is saying, you know what? I'm going to give you an extra little secret so that you could could know a little something, something more than what you think you know, because you think that this is everything. Oh my God, you got the title of an apostle. Oh my God, you got the title that you could do miracles. You put your hands on people and you hear them. Oh my God, you got the prophecy to speak in tongues. Paul saying, you know what? Let me school you and show you a little bit more. Amen. He says, this is the best. He says, but now let me show you a way of life that is best of all. So he's saying this is better than all that. He says, love is the greatest gift. If I could speak in all the languages on earth and of angels, but I didn't love others, I would only be a nosy going or clingy symbol. Amen. What is a nosy going or clingy symbol? It's somebody, he's using it as an interpretation. Like, you ever have your kids playing with, like, I know my kids, sometimes they play with the piano, and sometimes if I'm trying to have a conversation on the phone, it just gets on your nerves and you're like, can you please shut that piano off for just a second? And yes, I'm gonna try to write that down. Thank you so much. You know, or you ever have somebody, you know, just making noise around you and you're, oh, one comment, yes, you ever have, yes, that's exactly where I'm at, you ever have somebody just making noise and you just be like, could you, or your kids playing loud music and you ever be like, can you just turn the music down? He's saying that us as Christians, if we don't love people, we are in the eyes of God that same clingy noise, because to God, God is a God of love. He's a God of mercy. Mercy. He's a God of joy, of peace, and all that good stuff. But God, we have to also, we want our children to, our children are a reflection of us and who we are. So if you look at the condition of your children, that's going to really expose the condition of you, the mom or the father in the home, because our children always, they don't follow what they're told. They follow what they see. And Paul is trying to give us an example on this clingy noise and clingy symbol to give us a reflection to see that everything that we do, whether we have the gift of prophecy, whether we have the gift of miracles, whether we have these gifts, Paul is saying, look, in God's eyes, I'm going to teach you something. If you don't have this gift of love with what you're doing, if you're doing all these prophecies and all these miracles, and guess what? There's rumors out there of you talking about this person or you talking about that person, and you just always putting people down, and you don't have a good reputation within God's people of love. Like, people have to look at you, and sometimes people may not want to give that love, because everybody always be like, you feel like a sucker. You'd be like, oh man, everybody's always taking advantage of me because I'm such a nice person. I'd be a nice person. Don't nobody want to be my friend. Don't nobody want to hang out with me. You know, sometimes people may say to themselves, you know what, being nice doesn't pay off. But it depends what you're looking for and what you're seeking in your ministry. If you're seeking for the approval of men, then you're going to always have problems trying to prove yourself to everybody. And if you're looking for the approval of, you know, people just to get recognition, then you're never going to be able to do what it is that you're trying to do, because you don't have a genuine spirit, the genuine spirit of God, which is a spirit of love. Because before you could correct somebody, you got to make sure that they respect you. And for them to respect you, they have to look at your character. They have to see that, you know what, you represent what you preach. Amen. Because the Bible says that us as Christians, we're an open book. And some people, they like to hide their, you know, stuff under the carpet, and they like to, you know, put on their Sunday best and pretend that they have no issues. And, you know, they have these apostle titleships and they have these prophetic words that come out of their mouth. But guess what? When it comes time to the nitty gritty, like I was talking about yesterday, when you're posting things, excuse me, on your Facebook page, and the things that you're posting on your Facebook page is only good, you know, you're basically choosing to only show people the good part of your life. But in all reality, the true disciple of God, the true man or woman of God, has struggles every day. Why? Because you're trying to connect to God every day on a deeper level. You don't just find yourself, say, okay, well, I'm here, I'm already an apostle, I'm already a bishop, I'm already a pastor, well, I don't need to look for God no more, I don't have to go on my knees and go and pray and talk to God no more, I don't got to read the Bible for 40 minutes, 20 minutes. No, because remember, we have so many flaws, and we, like, when you feed yourself good and healthy things, you know, your body starts to change. It's also like that spiritually. When you start to submit to God on your knees and you start praying for your family, the people that hurt you, the people in your ministry, because I know that life is not perfect. You have problems in ministries. You have problems within families. You have problems in the homes. You have problems with the children. That's why we need to pull more from God so that God could give us, change our spirit, because the condition of our spirit has to be aligned with the word of God. So if you're feeding yourself good and healthy things and you see the changes in your body physically, if you give God what's due, out of love, because that's why God says to a lot of people, he says, yes, amen, glory to God. He says, you know what, if you go back, I have something against you. That's why people think, oh, once saved, always saved. No, God says that if you don't go back and do the works you did in the beginning, meaning you remember when you first met Christ and you first started to get to know God, you were always playing your music and you were always happy. But what happens? Sometimes you start getting too much knowledge and you start saying, okay, this person's of the devil, that person's of the devil, or this person committed adultery. And we just start focusing on everybody else and their flaws, and we don't know how to take the good and the bad. We're never going to be able to receive. We're never going to be able to grow, because we're going to stay in a level of being stuck and still, and then we get frustrated. Amen. Then we get frustrated and we get so upset because we're not growing. God is trying to open up, our spiritual eyes to say, look, you need to do things my way. Your way is not working. So do it my way and you're going to see my hand. You're going to see my glory. It's like the people, the children of Israel. Moses was so focused on everybody else that he didn't have time to focus on what God wanted him to do. And he didn't get to go to the promised land because everybody else, he was listening to everybody else saying, I'm thirsty, give me something to drink. And as a Christian, Moses knew where to focus his attention, but Moses got upset with the people because he said God didn't give you something to drink, but the people were thirsty. So Moses had to go and knock on that rock and get water, because the people were rebelling not only against God, but they were rebelling against Moses. And Moses is a servant of God, and Moses had to tell the people on God's behalf, God said it's not time for you to have anything to drink. You guys have to be thirsty. And who wants to be thirsty? It's like a dog being home all day. You leave a dog with no water. You give the dog a water bowl, they're gonna go like this, and you're gonna be like, oh my God, you're so thirsty. Yes, it's like us. We can become thirsty. Amen. And we have to submit ourselves to the fountain of life, which is God, Jesus Christ. We have to always be looking for living waters, and those living waters are in the Bible. Every problem that you're having, every thing that you're going through, it's in the word. Amen. So we're just gonna continue. So Paul is saying that if you have all these, he said, okay, I would only be a noisy going clingy cymbal if I had the gift of prophecy, and if I understood all the gifts of the secret plans and possessed all knowledge, and if I had such faith that I could move mountains, but I didn't even love others, I would be nothing. Now I'm gonna be honest with you. I know that it's very difficult to love everyone. I know that we as human beings, we have these these characteristics within us that sometimes we have a low tolerance of patience with people. I know that sometimes some people get on our nerves, but look at what Paul is saying. He understood that there's different kind of people. He's saying within the church, you're gonna have people that don't want to submit to God and his word. You're gonna have people that claim the title of bishop and apostles and all this stuff, and they have faith. But he's letting us know that, look, what is it worth if I have, yes, what is it worth if I have all these secret plans and possess all knowledge, and if I have faith that I could move mountains, but I did not love others, amen, I would be nothing. So he's saying that as Christians, we have to love other people. It doesn't mean that you got to sit there and be best friends with everyone, no. But he's saying that as a Christian, you have to learn how to carry yourself, amen. Hey, God bless you, sweetie. That's my sister right there. He says, yes, love is the greatest. He says, if I give everything and I have that I have to the poor and even sacrifice my body, I could boast about it, right? So he's saying, let's say I give everything that I have of me and I'm just running on E. Amen. Love you too, sweetie. Just because I'm trying to prove something to someone, what does that prove? That's not going to prove anything, that, oh my God, I'm on E. I've been working for God all day. I've been doing this. And he's saying I could boast about it, but if I didn't love others, I would have gained nothing. So he's saying it's like you're running a track and you're you're running a race and you're not going to have a prize at the end because you don't have love in your heart. And sadly, a lot of people, they take this word and they misinterpret it within the church and they don't read the whole paragraph. Amen. And this is something that I firmly believe that every, you know, we speak this in our church, you know, we let other people know love is patient and love is kind. It says love is not jealous or boastful or proud. And sadly, within the ministry of God, we have so many people being so arrogant in ministry, and they get up there and they grab their little microphone and they just, you know, and they walk on stage and walk off stage and they walk around like they better than everybody. And you know, you should always, even if you're walking off the stage, don't walk with that arrogant head. You know, smile at people, because those are people that are watching you. You're an open book to them. And if they always see that when it's worship time, you're not even focused on the service and you're just all the way in the back in another room and you're sitting there playing with your phone on Instagram and Snapchat and all that stuff, what does that say about you? You can't miss a word, because every word and every day that they preach the word, and especially if you're only on church on Sunday and you're doing that and you're in a church where they don't have services Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, and you're only there on Sunday and you're in worship team, I don't want to offend anybody, but you don't want to miss the blessing. And that's what Paul is saying. You God gave you this gift of prophecy to be a prophet. He gave you these gifts of healing. Don't miss out on the true blessing, on the true gospel, which is love. And how every time you, he says that faith comes by what? Hearing and doing the word of God. So you got to be meek. You can't walk around like the word is saying right here, boastful and proud because of the talents that you have. He says, or rude. It does not demand its own way. Love, it does not demand its own way. It is not irritable and it keeps no record of being wrong. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Amen. And it also says, love never gives up, never loses faith, and is always hopeful and endures through every circumstance. That means that through every circumstance, if you're in a church, you got to be faithful. Amen. We need Christ. And you know what, it's funny that you say that, because you know, that's a confirmation, because there was something else I was going to speak about. I was actually going to speak about interfaith today, because I posted something on my Facebook page, because there's a lot of pastors right now that are saying that that the Pope Francis, he said that all religions are worshiping the same God, and it's the same God, and it's one path to heaven. And I said, wait a minute. I said, didn't Jesus say that there's only one way to the Father, and that's through Jesus Christ the Son? So a lot of people, we have to be careful in these churches that we're submitted in, because if we don't have love, we ain't nothing. But if we don't have the truth and we don't stand up for this Bible right here, and like, you know, this right here is the word of God. And when he puts, yes, when he gives us this word, I don't know why there's so many pastors now talking about peace and interfaith. Like, you know, is this movement, and it's just like a lot of people, they either gonna be quiet about it, but I'm not. You know, I love God so much, and I know I'm not gonna stand there with a Buddha and a Muslim and because I love Christ and I want to be a good reflection. I don't care if it's anything, it could be political, whatever it is, I'm not gonna stand as about you know what, they heard the gospel before. There is a lot of people, they try to say, oh, you know, I have to be the light around them. They know the light, but believe me, they know the light. If God's gonna, you know, shake them up and do whatever he wants to with them. But if I'm going to stand next to a Buddhist and I'm going to stand next to a Muslim, I'm going to let them know that the heaven that you believe in is, let me tell you something, the only way to the one heaven that I know is through Jesus Christ. And if you believe in Muhammad and you believe in Buddha, I'm sorry, baby, but we ain't going to the same place. That's not what the word of God teaches me. Jesus teaches me that there's only one way. Yes, we love unconditionally. Yes, sister, but we do not compromise our convictions. Amen. And sadly, you got a lot of ministers that are doing this interfaith coexisting, and they just, you know, and you know, they may have love and they may be, you know, mingling with these people out of love. But guess what? When the Antichrist comes, he's not gonna come like no big gorilla or no big monster. They're gonna promote peace. How do you promote peace? How is the Antichrist gonna come in, and what is his agenda? The sister just said it right there, to make you compromise God's word. Amen. So just because you have all these titles, you know, Paul is teaching us through the word of God that we gotta have love, because if we don't have love with all these little things that we have nothing. Amen. So I pray that this word is a blessing to your life this morning. I really want to sit here and hang out more with you guys, but I have a homeschool field trip today that I'm planning. So I got to get together. Yes. Thank you so much, sweetie, to all the glory and all the honor be to God. I have a homeschool field trip today, so I have to get all the kids ready, and we're doing a lunch afterwards, like a little pizza party with the kids. So it's going to be fun. But like I said, if you want to continue to talk about anything or you have any questions, please find me on Facebook, Janice Batista. I'll be more than happy to answer any of your questions. And if any of you are ever in the Greensboro area, please feel free to stop by our church. Come check us out. Come visit us. Watch us on Facebook, Periscope every Sunday at 11 o'clock. And we're located in Greensboro, North Carolina. Okay, let me get out of here. I love you guys so, so, so very much. Okay, have a blessed day.